Recording now? Okay, great. Hi, everybody. I'm Christopher Hans-Soden. I'm one of the BRC consultants, and I'm going to be taking over the first half of this training on Savio. My colleague in the back there is Chris Petorek. He is also one of the consultants with BRC here, and also a professor in statistics. So this training is based off of our documentation that's online. Hopefully you've all been able to find this documentation on GitHub, and so you have access to it. We'll go through it a little bit quickly. I encourage you to go do things as we do them when you can, and where it's a little bit too fast for you, just come back and use this training as a reference and go through it on your own time. I'm going to be talking about how to get access to Savio, how to log into it, and the general system architecture of Savio. And then we'll go over logging in, getting data to and from Savio, and then managing the software on Savio. After that, Chris will take over with submitting jobs and actually getting the work done, as well as using Python on Savio. Savio is a Linux cluster, which is basically about 470, maybe a little bit more now, computers networked together to operate as if it was one machine. It is run under this condo model where about 40% of the nodes, or the kind of individual machines within Savio, are provided by the institution, and 60% are purchased by researchers and different research groups on campus and sit within it as part of this condo system. Don't need to update now. Okay, so the primary way that people get access to Savio is through the FCA, or Faculty Computing Allowance. Every faculty member on campus gets 300,000 service units, which are roughly equivalent to core hours on Savio. So just for reference, that's enough to have a 30-core machine running 24/7 for the entire year for every faculty member. Once the faculty members get those FCAs, they can then add any users to their allocation that they want. The second way that people get access is through the condo program. In that, you would pay for a certain number of nodes that live within Savio, and then you get priority access to that amount of resources whenever you need it. And then the third way that people get access is through an instructional computing allowance. So if you're teaching a course that has a heavy computational element, then you can come to us and we can provide access to Savio for that course. That really works best for semester-long courses, unfortunately not shorter workshops. Okay, so I already said that Savio is this Linux cluster. You access Savio by logging into it at one of the login nodes. And on these login nodes, you can access your files and manage your files. But then from there, you submit jobs to the compute nodes, which will actually do your heavy computation. There's also the data transfer nodes, which are used for getting data to and from Savio. So they have more types of networking enabled on them, and they're configured to facilitate the large amounts of data that come and go from Savio. Okay, here's a conceptual diagram of Savio and kind of its networking. You all start right up in here. This is your maybe laptop or something. At your workstation, and you use some kind of network protocol through the internet to access Savio. So that could be SSH is your primary login mode, SCP or FTP for transferring files, or also this service that I'm going to tell you about called Globus, which is also used for transferring files. Through SSH, you will be assigned to one of four login nodes, and that's just randomly. And you can switch between the login nodes, but that's kind of divided up randomly so that there aren't too many people sitting on one login node and using its resources at one time. For file transfers, you can SSH to the DTN, or you can also use one of these other protocols in conjunction with the DTN. All of the nodes in Savio have access to its file systems. So I'm going to zoom out here a little bit so you can see the full diagram. There we go. So there are three main file systems on Savio, and every single node, no matter where you are or where you're working in Savio, has access to those same file systems. And we'll talk more about that. And then from the login nodes, you use the Slurm scheduler to submit or kind of request an allocation of some amount of resources for some period of time. The scheduler tries to find a slot where that's available and puts it in according to the rules of the scheduler, which we'll talk about. And it may go to one of several different partitions within Savio. So we'll get into all of that. Any questions on this diagram before we move on? Okay, we'll come back to it. Okay, so as I said, there are several different partitions, which are pools of nodes within Savio. Every machine within a partition has identical architecture, but the different machines between the different partitions have different architectures or different resources. So if you go to the Savio training documentation, you can see the scheduler, that's the scheduler configuration, hardware configuration. So in our user guide, under hardware configuration, the Savio 1 pool consists of 164 nodes that each have 64 gigabytes of memory and 20 cores, while the Savio 2 pool has 136 nodes, 24 cores, 64 gigs of memory, and et cetera. So you can see the partitions that are available there and what their specific resources are. This is the same page. Okay. A little bit lower down, under the scheduler configuration, you can see, these are, the partitions, but this is how you would know which partitions you might have access to, or how to name them when you're requesting your jobs. So for example, Savio 1, the accounts starting with FC often have access to that. And some, if you have a condo allocation, you could look that up there. Great. Okay, so the file systems on Savio, there are kind of three main areas of file systems. The primary ones are your home directory, which is going to be in this global home users, and then your username path. And then the scratch directory, which is under global scratch, and then your username. The home directory is limited to 10 gigabytes per user. So that space is designed to have your scripts, some of your kind of documents, and other personal type files. It's not designed to hold your research data. That should really go into scratch. And some users will also have access to other file systems, such as the group, the group's file systems, or other storage that they've purchased through the condo program. That is designed to kind of archive and store data that's not currently being used. But anytime you're doing actual computation on a set of data, it should be within Scratch. And the reason for that is that Scratch is networked to the compute nodes and the DTN through the very fast InfiniBand architecture. And that's designed to handle the kinds of input and output that we get when we have thousands of users doing heavy computation. The home directory and the other file systems on Savio are just networked with Ethernet. If you do computation on data in those locations, it's going to bog down the entire system and prevent access to everybody. So please make sure that you keep your data in Scratch. Okay, so now that we've gone over the overview, we'll get to actually logging into Savio. SSH is the method which you're going to use to gain access to Savio. And the format for that command, you're going to need to have some kind of SSH client. On Mac and Linux, that's just going to be there by default in your terminal. If you're using Windows, a good option is PuTTY, and your access may look a little bit different using PuTTY. But Mac and Linux users, your command is going to be SSH, then your username, and then there's two locations. For the login nodes, it's going to be hpc.brc.berkeley.edu. So I'll go ahead and log in myself. Okay. When you do that, you'll be prompted to be asked for your password. Your password consists of your personal PIN followed by the one-time PIN or one-time password provided by the Google Authenticator app. So I enter my personal PIN, and then immediately afterwards, I enter the one-time password. Great. And this you won't see. This is my GitHub. So that's just me. OK, so now I've logged into Savio. It drops me into my home directory. At the top of my terminal, you can see that I was assigned to login node 001. And I can look around, see that I have a bunch of files. I'm currently in my home directory. And my scratch directory is going to be set and reset your PIN. The instructions for setting up the authenticator and your account are linked here. And so just kind of go through that on your own time. If you have difficulties with that process, you can contact us for help.
So the login node is random, right?
Yeah, the login node is random. Although you can specify a specific login node, I believe. Or once you're on, I can switch to a different login node. I do need to enter my password again. Sorry, one more time. Yeah, so if there's a problem with one login node, then you might want to switch. If you're using a session manager, can't remember the name of some of the popular ones. Tmux, yeah, like that. Then that will be running on a specific login node, so to get back into that session, you would want to be on that node. If another user is behaving badly and running their computations on the login node, and that's bogging it down, then you can switch to one of the other three. And also, please let us know, and we'll stop that.
How would you know when things are not running?
So you can monitor the kind of status of the node using usual Unix commands. Such as top. And so here I can see the top processes that are running on the login node, as well as some of the resources that are available. So if things aren't behaving well and you run top and you see that somebody's running a Python process that's using 700% of the CPU, then that could be a problem. Right now it's looking fine. Okay, one option that you might want to know for this SSH command is the -y option. So this enables X11 forwarding, which allows me to use GUI type applications through SSH. services. HPC.br, or is it BRC HPC? Yeah. One of the joys of using Savio is getting to enter one-time passwords a lot. Okay, so now I can run a program that has a graphical interface like Emacs, and rather than getting the Emacs within the shell, I now have a nice, you know, Emacs window forwarded to my machine. If I didn't have that -y option, I would get a, you know, it would just be within the shell.